tonight the greatness of God in this house. Can we give him praise? Hallelujah. Tonight, you are greater than all. You are greater than anyone. We bless you tonight. Hallelujah.
Water you turn into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no thank you.
need to remind the enemy of that. My God is greater. My God is stronger. There is none above him. It reminds me of a story I heard one time. A wife had signed, she and her husband, up to go to tour a vacation rental. And in exchange, they were supposed to get a free TV. And the husband was not real thrilled with his wife for signing him up to go to tour this vacation rental. But he didn't mind the idea of a free TV. And so on the day they were supposed to go, they went. And the salesperson, and you know how they are, they're pretty high pressure. He did his sales pitch and showed them everything. And he began to ask the husband, "Now, don't you think you would like to come and spend vacation here?" And the husband's response was, "I want my free TV." "Well, don't you think your family would like to come and spend a week here?" "I want my free TV." That's all he said to that man. "I want my free TV." That's all we need to say to the devil. My God is greater. No matter what he says, no matter what he tries to convince you of, my God is greater. Can we give him praise? My God is greater. My God is stronger.
God, you are higher than any other. My God is healer. Awesome in power. Our God. Our God. Our God is greater. My God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other.
Hallelujah. Give him a hand clap of praise. Just worship him. Worship him. Going to be reading from Psalm 150. It says, "Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty firmament. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the lute and harp. Praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise him with stringed instruments and flutes." Somebody needs to praise him right now. "Praise him with the loud cymbals. Praise him with the clashing cymbals. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord." Worship with the choir as they sing.
Continue to worship with the choir. You're welcome to remain standing.
Lift up the name above all names.
Does anybody believe that Jesus Christ came into the world? Does anybody believe that Jesus died for your sin and my sin? Does anybody believe that Jesus conquered death, hell, and the grave, got up on the third day? Do you believe in the resurrection? I can't hear you. Do you believe in the resurrection? Hallelujah. Do you believe he's coming back again? Do you believe in the any moment coming of Christ? Any moment, any time, could be while we're gathered here in the name of the Lord, singing praise to his name. Could be while we are lifting holy hands that Jesus comes, steps out, splits the eastern sky, steps out on a cloud, calls us, blows that trumpet. The dead in Christ will rise. We which are alive and remain shall be called up together to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. That excites me. I hope it excites you. That excites me. I want you to stand all over the building. This is our time to pray. But I don't want us to pray for needs, and I know we have a lot of them. I know we have people that have had surgery and recuperating at home, and those that are facing surgery. I understand all about that. But I want us to pray tonight that God would touch us in a way that our ears hear every word, that our heart and spirit is so open to receive every word. I want every seed that is planted tonight to fall on good ground. I want it to be fertile ground. I want it when it begins to burst forth, I want it to bring forth good fruit. How many of you want God to work in you the way He wants to work in you? And that's what I'm asking tonight. I want you to pray that God will have His way in this place. Will you join me in that prayer tonight? Father God, we join all over this room tonight. While we understand there are needs, while we understand that there are sicknesses and recuperating from surgery, and there are people of all kinds who need us, Lord, the greatest need that I can think of tonight, Lord, are those of us that are in this room. We are here, Lord, because we want to experience a moving of your glory. We want to experience a moving of your spirit. We're here tonight, Lord, because we want to come in contact with you. The resurrected Savior, the Holy Spirit that given us new life, that's the one that we want to encounter tonight. That's the one that we want to come in contact with tonight. And I pray tonight, Lord, that everyone in this room would have already, if they have not done it before they walked into the room, will do it now. Prepare their hearts and minds to receive, Lord, what it is that you want to give us tonight. Lord, I believe we're not here by accident. I don't believe we're here because there's nothing else to do. We're here tonight because, Lord, you have divinely orchestrated this time together. I believe, Lord, this is the moment that you have given each one of us. And it's up to us, Lord, to do our part, to be ready to receive, to see with eyes that are wide open, to hear with ears that are wide open, to have hearts and spirits that are wide open, so that we can receive the wondrous word of the Lord. And then, Lord, when it comes that time for the altar, don't let us be bound that we're afraid to move. God, whatever you speak to us, let us be like the mother of Jesus who said to them at the wedding of Cana, whatever he says to you, do it. May that be our saying mandate tonight. Whatever the Spirit of the Lord says to us to do, let us do it. If we're supposed to move forward, let us do it. If we're bound by things and the Spirit says tonight you need to be free, let us be free. Lord, tonight, if we're supposed to make a move forward, let us make a move forward. Whatever we're supposed to do, let us do it tonight as we're directed and moved upon by your Spirit. We pray for the anointing to rest upon our evangelist tonight. Pray, God, that you would be glorified through his life. But, Lord, hide him behind the cross of Calvary, because, Lord, it's really not him we're interested in tonight. It's the word of the Lord. All of us are mere carnal beings. And we want to hide behind the cross so that people don't see us or hear us, but that they hear the word of God. And I ask that you anoint him tonight, Lord, and use him. And God, we'll be careful to give you praise and glory and to honor and magnify your name. For you are worthy. And we bless you and we praise you for it. In the wonderful name, the mighty name, the glorious name of Jesus our Lord. And everybody said, amen. Why don't you just look beside you? Might be somebody you're standing beside you don't know, or maybe you haven't seen them in a while. Why don't you just speak to them? You don't necessarily have to get out of your seat, but just let them know that you're so glad to see them tonight. We're honored and blessed that you are with us. If you're our guest tonight, please know how grateful, how thankful we are that you have come to share with us tonight. It is truly, truly a blessing. Amen. Amen. We are glad to have with us tonight Pastor Neil Nolan, his wife Jessica, son Aiden. Aiden's grown up a lot since he was here. Also glad to have his youth pastor, Billy Norris, and his lovely wife as well with us tonight. We're glad to have all of you with us tonight. We're so thankful that you're here. We don't want to belabor the point. We're going to ask our ushers to come and wait upon us tonight. You have helped us last weekend to be able to bless the man of God and his ministry. Again, remember that what we do is a ministry beyond just standing in the pulpit, and we do believe the workman is worthy of his hire, but it's all that is entailed in getting him to this place and getting him back home. We're grateful that he's come from Columbia to be with us. They'll be driving back home tonight, then he'll be back here tomorrow night, and we're anxious about that. And we're also very blessed tomorrow morning to have our pastor emeritus and our senior adult pastor, Pastor Sheely, will be bringing the word in the morning. And we're very excited about that as well. We're glad he's come all the way from Greenville, South Carolina, to preach to us in the morning. But we're looking forward to that word as well. We know all of these men have heard from God, and that's what I'm interested in. So please help us tonight with a generous gift to bless Brother Neil and his ministry. You know him. I'm not going to get back up here after this and say any more about him, but you know his ministry. He's been here many times. He's tried. He's proven. And we know he's a man of God. He hears from God. The Lord uses him in the altar services as well. And we're blessed that he was willing to come back and share with us. And this is a way for us to bless him. It's also a way for us to worship the Lord. And that's what I'm interested in too. I love to worship. And I want to do that tonight as well. Pray with me, would you? Father God, thank you for the privilege and opportunity we have to be gathered in this place tonight. Lord, no greater thing we could do than to worship you, to bless you, to honor you. And we're thankful for that. And Lord, we're thankful that we have the opportunity to give gifts to bless your name, first of all. But then, Lord, we also give tonight to bless the man of God that's come this way to share with us. We've always believed in taking care of those that labor and are used by you. And we don't want to do anything differently tonight than we've done before. And so, God, I pray that you'll speak to our hearts and help us to use our gifts to bless them. I bless you for all that you do, already have done, and for what you will do. We give you glory and praise for it in the name of Jesus. Amen.
The room grew still as she made her way to Jesus. She stumbled through the tears that made her blind. She felt such pain, and some spoke with anger. Heard folks whisper, "There's no place here for her kind." Still on she came through the shame that flushed her face, till at last she knelt before his feet. And though she spoke no words, everything she said was heard as she poured her love for the Master from her box of to pour my praise on him like oil from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry, I wash his feet with my tears, and I dry them with my hair. Oh, you weren't there the night he found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his loving arms around me. And you don't know the cost of the oil in my alabaster box. The way life used to be, I was a prisoner to the things that had me bound. And I spent my days pouring my life without measure into the little treasure box I thought I'd found. Until the day to me, he filled my soul with the wonder of his touch. So now I'm giving back to him all the praises worthy of. I've been forgiven, that's why I love him so much. And I've come to pour my praise on him like oil from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and dry them with my hair. Oh, oh, see, you weren't there the night you found me. You did not feel what I felt when you wrapped his loving arms around me. And you don't know the cost of the oil. Oh, you don't know the cost of my praise. Of the oil in my alabaster box. I praise you, Lord. I praise you, Lord.
Hallelujah. As the pastor prepares to come, will we stand one more time and enter into a place of worship? Lord, we worship you tonight. There's a calm that covers me. When I kneel down at your feet, it's a place of healing, it's a place where I find freedom. There's a place my eyes can't see, to be. It's a place of healing, it's a place I'll live in freedom. I'm gonna lift my
bring me peace that can wash me clean like you, Lord.
Come on.
There's nothing in this world that can free me.
Shout it out.
Oh, you saved my soul. I'm gonna lift my hands till I can reach heaven. I'm gonna shout for joy till the walls come falling down. I come to worship. I come to worship.
God, the biggest hand clap of praise we can. Amen. Hallelujah. Let somebody praise the Lord. I wish I had three people that would take 30 seconds and tell God if it had not been for him, they wouldn't be here. I wish I had two people who do not care about what nobody else thinks. But I just want to say, God, this week was your breath. It was your touch that kept me, kept my mind, kept me in perfect peace. Anybody know what I'm talking about? We're living in a wicked hour where the touch of man won't do. Amen? I need the touch of the Holy Ghost to comfort me and help me in hard times such as this. Amen? Amen? Amen. So good to see you. Just remain standing. If you have your Bibles, I want you to grab them, please. Go with me to the book of 1 Samuel, chapter 16. Music was excellent. Have us right where we need to be. Sister Porter, all those in the choir, our musicians, thank you so much. The way you present music with excellence upon our heavy anointing. Will you give them a hand and appreciate them tonight, please? Amen. Never take it for granted. Amen. So good to see Pastor Sheely, as always. I give honor where honor is due. It was his invitation that led me here many years ago. And I pray I have lived up to something, not my preaching, but, you know, Brother Sheely's a man of God, amen? Man of character and integrity. He carries that in this state. And I pray I've lived up in a way and represented his pulpit in a way that he is pleased. I always give honor to you, Brother Sheely. You give him a hand, please, amen? If I knew he was preaching in the morning, I would have counseled tomorrow night. Amen. He's a preacher's preacher. And Brother Terry, always good to be with you and your family, your pastoral staff, and your counsel here, and your leadership. I know you always have the table set and prepared that when I get here and other evangelists get here, people have been praying and fasting. You do not take it for granted. I'm honored to be here. You know, it's my custom, I do not mention anything about money or anything to the last night. I always just give a thank you. I've never done that. I will never be one that sidesteps that. Amen. I trust you. I know that you've always blessed me more than I ever could dream. You understand that. But I feel more comfortable not in that before preaching. I feel comfortable when we get to the Word. Does that make sense? Amen. I do want to make mention, it's good to have our children's pastors with us. This is Brother Billy and Sister Beth Norris. They both are credentialed ministers in the Church of God. They're from Sherrill, South Carolina. Now they're partnering with me in ministry in the Midlands of West Columbia. It's so good to have them. He was actually driving me tonight, amen, so I could study a little more. It's good to have my wife Jessica with us. We're about 3 weeks away from little Ashton being with us. Jess, if you would stand, I know you don't want to stand, your feet are hurting, but if you would stand, amen. Amen. Would you wave? Give them a beauty pageant wave, amen. Amen. She's a singer. She's like your pastor's wife. She leads our music for singing. And I want you to be in prayer with me. I'm so anxious to see my child, but we need her to wait to Easter. Once we get one, I know it's wrong. I know it is. I know I shouldn't pray that way, brother. But listen, we're going to have all kind of people there on Resurrection Sunday. We celebrate, amen. She said, I can't believe you're praying that way. I said, listen, I'm pastor. I've got to pray that way. But time we leave the sanctuary, I don't care on the way to Burger King. Let's go. Yeah, I'm ready. Amen. So it's so good to have her. It's also good to have Aiden with me. Aiden has always been my right hand in ministry for many years. You know him when it was just me and him coming. You helped me so much. He was a lot younger then and a lot shorter. Now he's hitting baseballs and hitting home runs and things like that. And Dad's happy, and it's good to have him. Will you make them feel special, please? Amen. Praise the Lord. Tonight, I want to share a word with you that's a very unusual word. If I would have my way tonight, I would quickly go to tomorrow night's message. I believe that God is wanting to push this church this weekend. I believe God is wanting to push some of you to a risky faith because many of us are too comfortable in the church. And because of our being comfortable and complacent, a lot of things are being allowed, maybe not at Woodruff, but in the church world. A lot of practices that are sinful, they're carnal, and they're taking root in the church. And they're birthing things that we're going to pay for now, but the next generation is going to be persecuted for. And we need to wake up. It's past time that we wake up. Tomorrow night, I'm going to address us to push forward, to let go of everything that has held us back, and to be risky in God, to do more than even what's asked of us, maybe like the old church. Sometimes the old church would go a little bit further, not sinful, not fleshly or worldly, but they will go one step further just to be closer to the Lord. It's kind of like Ruth. Naomi says, I want you to go lay at his feet. Well, she does that, but then she gets a little risky and bold. Then she not only lays at Boaz's feet, she says, but will you lay your garment over me? Naomi didn't ask her to go that far. But see, sometimes when you get so close to the master, you realize sometimes you just got one opportunity to grab a hold of something that God has for you. That's what I want to preach tomorrow night. But tonight, I cannot get away with it. I've got a word for somebody, maybe just one. I've got a letter. I told the pastor, I said, Pastor, if I miss it, if it's not what you anticipated, I take the blame for it. It's fully on me. But I believe with everything that's within me, I was up very early this morning praying that I have something to say to somebody and to this church. I want you to go to 1 Samuel 16, and I know what you're thinking already. We're about to hear a story on David and Goliath. No, you're not. I want to go to verse 1, and that is where I will hang my message. And that's what I'm going to preach from. I feel him in this house. I got something to say to somebody. Now I want you to get ready. Now the Lord said to Samuel, how long will you mourn for Saul, seeing how I have rejected him from reigning over Israel? Fill your horn with oil, and go, I'm sending you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided, somebody say provided, I have provided myself a king among his sons. Let me go back. How long will you mourn for Saul? Heavenly Father, this is your word. I have given my life to this word. I have been persecuted for preaching this word. But God, I love that word. God is preaching, and there's no preaching to me that's outside of that word. It's just telling stories, entertaining people. It's just causing people to feel good about their present state. But it has no power, it has no effect. Many preachers will go to a pulpit tomorrow, and they will preach something cute, something somebody wants to hear. But Paul would tell Timothy, they would preach something that would cause people to, it would be what their ear would desire to hear, but that's not my style, God. I'm from the old school. That means, God, I've got to hear from you, and if I don't hear from you, then I have nothing to say. If I don't hear from you, how can I stand before your people and tell them that I heard from you? Isn't that a lie? So, Father, I have prayed and I have sought you. And, God, I feel like you have put something in my spirit to say to this wonderful congregation who I am unworthy to stand before. But, Father, if you would use me as you have in times past, if you would let the anointing sit upon me, God, that when I leave here, I would declare and I promise that I will give nobody glory but you. Father, if you would grant me that prayer this night, I will be forever grateful. Father, I love you. I thank you. Now use me, I ask. And everybody said, amen. You may be seated. Amen. Thank you. I want to preach just for a few moments, young people, a subject entitled, Getting Over What I've Got to Get Over. I believe that for this church to be who God has called her to be, we cannot be stuck in neutral. We cannot be passive. We cannot sit back and play games. We cannot rest on yesterday's victories, but we must keep moving forward. We cannot allow anything to prohibit us from going forward. Can't play blame games. Can't talk about who's left. Can't talk about something we could have done or something we should have done. We have to live in the now, the present. We have to take the day that God has given us and be a good steward of that day, as Paul would tell the Corinthian church. Focused. With a focused mindset and vision, not so much of a spiritual type mindset of today that is not focused, that we have so much that we're confused. We got so much Facebook and Twitter, and got so much going on in the world that really we just come to church as a token now. We do that to stay a part of the choir. We go to church to stay a part of the fellowship. We go to church to make sure they don't kick us out of church. We go to church to make sure the pastor doesn't call me, because we don't want the pastor coming to our house, because we don't want him coming in our door because it's dirty. So let's go to church at least one time this month so we'll make sure that Pastor Terry stays home. Is anybody listening? We're not moving forward. We're stopped. We're stuck in neutral. And the sad part is, it's not many things. Usually it's one thing that stops a church. Could be racism. Could be pride. It could be holding on to yesterday. It could be afraid to move forward. It could be afraid to do what God is calling us to do, because the call of God is too big for us. We don't understand it. Can't comprehend it in our carnality. We can't understand it in totality, because we're hearing something, but it sounds so big that it scares us to death. And it's stopping us, and it has the church stuck in neutral. And it's not just for the corporate bodies, for us as individuals as well. Sickness, death, divorce, somebody hurting us, somebody done us wrong, something that happened in our childhood. And what happens is that God should be using us mightily and greatly, but we're stuck in neutral. We're not moving forward. We're upset with the pastor. We're upset with somebody. We're upset with a vote. We're upset with the church. We're upset with Cleveland and Malden. We're upset with the president and politicians. But let's just be honest tonight. There comes a place that you have to be accountable for your life. I can't live it for you. Brother Sheila can't live it for you. The pastor can't live it for you. You got to make up in your own mind that, you know what? I can't waste another day on childish living. I can't waste another day being trivial. I can't waste another day crying over spilled milk. I can't waste another day saying, I wish somebody wouldn't have left the church. For me and my house, we've just got to make up our mind. Everybody else may be going to Moab, but I've made up my mind. I'm going to persevere to a holy city. I got my mind fixed on a holy God, and my vision is set. If you believe that, will you give God a hand clap of praise tonight? My assignment tonight is to get you up and get you moving. My assignment this weekend is to get you up, get you past what's hurting you, get you to dream and risk and hope again. That is my assignment. I heard it clearly from the Holy Spirit. My assignment is to wake something up inside of you that's been dormant, something that's been sitting there and it's been sitting idle because you lost your job, your boss doesn't like you, your dog won't play with you, and the person at Walmart won't greet you. But sooner or later, you got to quit crying. Some of us need to be mature in the Lord. It's like the book of James. Sooner or later, you just got to grow up. We need to preach a message in the church. That's the message we need to preach. Grow up. This is not Chuck E. Cheese, where everybody's going to get along with a stamp on your hand. This is the house of God. We deal with devils. We handle spiritual things. We deal with divorce and houses being torn apart. We deal with generational boundaries that have been set by the devil, and he refuses us to cross. But I believe that God is trying to find a remnant of people. I believe that God is trying to find a few people that are not afraid to say, you know what? I can't do it by myself, but me and the Holy Ghost. Ghost, if the Holy Ghost doesn't in me, if the Holy Ghost would empower me, I might can do something greater in the spiritual than I can ever do in the natural. Here's where my assignment is tonight. It's found in 1 Samuel 16. I know it's a familiar story, and every young preacher, and we have some here tonight, and I commend them from being here on a Saturday night for church and revival. Will you give them a hand coming from North Spartanburg? Amen. You're doing the right thing, young man. I know that you're dating her and y'all engaged, but if she won't come to church on Saturday night, then you know she's not the one. Amen. 1 Samuel 16, it's a familiar story. When I mentioned that, some of you said, oh, not that. I should have stayed home. He's going to talk about David and Goliath, and he's going to talk about David. No, that's not what I'm preaching. In fact, I believe we have missed it as preachers because we just jumped to David, and we every preacher's preached that. We preached about the boy on the backside of the sheep field, and nobody's come to get him. We preached all that. I've preached it, Brother Sheely, Brother Terry, all these young preachers. They preached about David and how he was a ruddy and good-looking young boy, but he wasn't recognized. It's a beautiful, beautiful story. I love it. It preaches. It preaches. In fact, if you really want to preach it, go back to the book of Ruth when it talks about Obed, and go back to the book of Ruth and how God would bring somebody from Moab and hook her up with Boaz, and she would dream and get risky, and the next thing you know, they're placed together, and then there would come a David, but David would bring a Jesus in Matthew chapter 1. It's a beautiful story to preach, but that's not my message. My message is in verse 1, because if we don't have verse 1, we don't have David being called from a sheep field. In verse 1, what we have here is, let me give you the background. Israel wanted a king like the rest of the nations. So God gave them a man by the name of Saul. He was a man's man. He stood head and shoulders over everybody else. But when God called him, he wasn't looking to be king. When God called him, he was just out chasing animals for his father. He was humble. He was meek at that time. He was just out really being a youthful young boy, and God calls him to be king. In fact, on the day they were crowned him to be king, he was so much not getting the political seat that he was hiding out amongst the baggage, and Samuel had to say, somebody go find him for me, please. God calls him to be king, and God anointed him, and God gave him favor, and God gave him victories, and God was great in his life. However, over time, just like a lot of people that once felt the anointing of God, my granddaddy would say he got a little too big for his britches. I don't think you can say that in Woodruff, but I did. Over time, he began to do his old thing. In fact, in 1 Samuel 13, he demanded, because Samuel was running late and he was worried about the people of God. Saul, in 1 Samuel 13, he stepped outside of his anointing. He stepped outside of his boundary, and he performed a duty that was not left up to him, but was left up to Samuel. He thought, you know what? I can do what I want to. I'm the one that's going to be king. And I know Samuel's not here, and I know he's the one that should do it. But listen, I'm the one in charge now, so I'll do what I want to do. And he stepped outside of his boundary. It was a warning sign. It was a sign that pride had gripped inside of him. It was a sign that he had lost when he was little in his own sight. And because of this, he was rebuked by Samuel. When Samuel arrived, he asked him, he said, what have you done this day? He said in verse 14, I know that you thought your kingdom would last forever, but I'm telling you, your kingdom is coming to an end. In fact, God's already found another man, and this man is a man after God's own heart. You know it's a sad day when your pride and your sin push you to a place that you lose out on God. And not only do you lose out on God, but God's already got somebody else to take your place. I know you thought the church wouldn't survive without you, and I know you thought that a church wouldn't make it without you. And I know this might be for somebody listening on the internet, but at least you don't, nobody knows this, you, since you're in your own home by yourself. But I want somebody to know that the kingdom of God is not established nor built on you. The kingdom of God is based on Jesus Christ, nothing more, nothing less. It's based on Jesus Christ and his righteousness. Paul told the church at Colossae, it is the sufficiency of Christ that prevails us and not the sufficiency of man. So when God begins to deal with him now, because of this, we see a downward spiral in the life of Saul, of him rejecting the voice of God and doing his own thing. Is anybody listening? I'm going somewhere, just hang on. In 1 Samuel 15, though, it didn't take long in two chapters. Now all this would come to pass, and it would be the final straw from God. 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 8, he was given specific instructions. God said, I want you to kill all the Amalekites. I want you to kill everything. They have opposed me and my people. I want you to destroy every animal. I want you to kill the king. I want you to do it all, and I'm going to help you, but this is a task. In verse 8 of that chapter, though, Saul doesn't do that. The Bible said that Saul and the people, and that's very important, they spared Agag, and they took the best of the spoil. Verse 13, Samuel comes, and Saul's there, and Saul brags to him, brother. Saul says, man of God, we did it, didn't we? Woo, we did just what you said. We killed everything. And the man of God looks at Saul and says, Saul, if you did what God said, then why do I hear the animals bleeding in my ear? If you obeyed the voice of God, then why do I hear the animals of the enemy crying out? I don't know who I come to preach to tonight, but you better be careful serving God halfway. Some of you got a halfway religion. You're in the church half the time, the other time you're not. Half the time you're praising God, and the other half the time you're mad. Half the time you're tithing, the other time you're giving it to the lottery ticket. Half the time you're praying for your pastor, the other half the time you're praying he leaves. Half the time you're being the man of your home, and half the time you're up late at night watching something you shouldn't be watching. That halfway religion will get you nowhere. That halfway religion will get you placed out of the choir. That halfway religion, Brother Nolan, you shouldn't judge anybody, you're right. We shouldn't judge those out there in the world. They don't know God. We should lead them to a place of salvation. But let me read to you the book of Corinthians. Paul said, you tell that man that's practicing sexual immorality in the church, I want you to turn him out that his soul might be saved at the day that the Lord comes. Let somebody preach that one more time. Let somebody preach that again. What that means is a drunkard may not know better. But if you've been in this church long enough, you know better. You know there's a way to walk. You know there's a standard to uphold. You know there's a lifestyle to live. I know nobody wants to live it anymore. I know nobody wants to walk in a path of righteousness, but I made up my mind. Every time I sold to the flesh, I reap corruption. But every time I sold to the Holy Ghost, I reap everlasting. I want to sow in the Spirit and let the Spirit bless me one more time. Come on, if you believe that, give God a hand clap of praise. Samuel said, if you would obey me, I would hear this noise. But verse 17 of chapter 15 is prophetic. Samuel said this. He said, when you were little in your own sight. Somebody say that with me. Say it with me. Come on, say it again. I went back. I didn't understand that. So I went back and I read it a couple times today. When God called Saul to be king, Saul said these words. You got the wrong person. I'm a Benjamite, which is the smallest of tribes. I come from the worst family of the smallest of tribes. I think you got the wrong person. And he said, no, it's you. And he said, when you were little in your own sight, did I not raise you up? In fact, when God spoke to him the first time through Samuel, he said these words, why are you speaking to me? It's like when you asked your wife out on the date for the first time and she said, yes. Wanted to really ask her, I can't believe you really just said yes. Men, that's when you say amen right there. Amen. I helped two people out. The other ones, you missed it. That was a walk-off home run for you right there. You got to do better, men. Saul blames the people in verse 21. He said, God, it wasn't me. Doesn't that sound just like the Garden of Eden? When man fell in sin the first time, it severed the relationship with God, severed the relationship with humanity. God, I didn't do it. It's the woman that you gave me. That's what happens with sin. When sin gets involved, we start blaming people for what we did wrong. I tell my son all the time, when you come to me and you say it was me, Daddy, that's when, son, I know that you're doing good. But when you blame your teacher and you blame the person beside of you, you blame everybody else but you, I can't hear you because I know that's not the truth. We need some people to practice that in the church. Will you stand up and say it was me, Pastor? I talked about you. I was wrong for doing it. And I want forgiveness. It was me, Pastor. I robbed the church. It was me, Pastor. I laid out. It was me, Pastor. It wasn't nobody's fault. It wasn't your wife's fault. It was my fault. Is anybody listening tonight? He said, listen. He said, and you know the story. Rebellion is a sin of witchcraft and all that. And finally he says this. He said, God has rejected you to be king. And go down to verse 35. And this is where I want to preach now. That's just the introduction. In verse 35, it closes out chapter 15. In verse 35, something happens to Samuel. If you'll turn me up just a little bit right here, please. In verse 35, the Bible says that he begins to mourn. It's all right. It's all right. He says that the Bible says that Samuel begins to mourn. Do you see that? It says in verse 35, Samuel went no more to see Saul unto the day of his death. Nevertheless, Samuel mourned for Saul. Now pick up verse 16. Now the Lord said to Samuel, how long will you mourn for that that I have rejected? Are you listening tonight? The very first word spoken in chapter 16 is not about David. The very first word that's spoken is to the man of God to ask him something. Samuel, how long are you going to keep crying for something that I've already done away with? I don't know who I come to preach to tonight, but I know God sent me here with a specific word. I don't want an extra offering. I'm not asking you to put nothing in my pocket. I'm not asking for anything for me. I'm telling you I got a letter for somebody. And the Holy Spirit sent me to ask somebody this word. How long are you going to keep mourning for something that God has already done in your life? How long are you going to keep crying about some hurt and some pain that you've already experienced? How long are you going to miss out on what God has for you just because some preacher claimed to be a man of God, but he hurt you and he stabbed you in the back? How long are you going to keep crying? I'm not trying to belittle you, and I'm not trying to be insensitive, but how long are you going to stay back in your hurt and pain because somebody walked out of your life? I come to tell you that your life is more than what you think it is. And I come to preach to somebody tonight that what you went through is not the final chapter in your story. And I come to let somebody know that where you put a period, God was trying to put a comma. And what you thought was going to be your finality, it's not. It's just halfway through the story. And God has sent me here to tell somebody it's time for you to pull out a hanky and wipe the tears out of your eyes, because God is wanting to use you again for His glory. But you got to quit crying for what happened yesterday in your life. You've got a hand clap of praise if you believe that. The reason we do this, we start mourning because we don't have any hope. That's why at our funerals we may cry, but our crying don't stay forever. You want to know why? Because of 1 Corinthians 15. Because of 1 Thessalonians chapter 3 and chapter 4. We're not ignorant. We have the words of the Lord. The Apostle Paul gives to us that our loved ones that die, we know exactly where they're at. 1 Corinthians 15, Corinthians starts out with the cross and ends up with the resurrection. Did you ever notice that? In chapter 2, he talks about the wisdom of the cross compared to the wisdom of man. And in chapter 15, he closes with the resurrection of Jesus Christ. You don't get a better book than starting with the cross and ending with the resurrection. That's good by itself. And that's what happens there. But through it all that, we have hope. Samuel is mourning here because he has no hope. And when people have no hope, they're desperate. That's why Elimelech goes to Moab. And that's why Naomi comes back and says, don't call me by Naomi anymore. She says, call me Mara. And she said, because the Lord has sent me out full and brought me home empty. That wasn't true. She didn't come home empty. She came home with Ruth. But you have no hope. And when you have no hope, you're blind. And when you're blind, you can't see. You can't see that God's already providing for you. You can't see the little things because you're still crying about something that happened 5 years ago. Well, Brother Nolan, I don't have the car I used to have, but you're not walking. Start walking. You'll thank God for the Pinto. Oh, preacher, that's not biblical. I just saw that preacher want that $65 million plane. You don't want my opinion on that. Are you listening? But Brother Nolan, my health's not like it used to be. Well, mine's not either. I'm 36 years old, half bald, out of shape. When I was 16, I threw a ball a long way and I was in shape. I'm getting old. But that doesn't mean God's not God. That don't mean you got to stay home. That don't mean you got to get mad. Well, I want a God to heal me for this. I want a God to heal me for that. Well, that's good. But some things are not even God's problem. There's a lot of us that can lose weight. That's not God's problem, nor the devil's problem. That's because we like to eat. It's not spiritual. It's physical. We like to go to Broncos and get a taco. Are you listening? That's what he's saying right here. The reason that Samuel is crying because he has no hope. And when people have no hope, they quit dreaming. And when they quit dreaming, they lack faith. And when they lack faith, they don't step out with God. And that's why people don't walk on water. And that's why people don't build churches. And that's why people don't dream anymore, because they have no hope. We need hope. The book of 1 Peter is about hope. We need hope back in the church. Why are you sad? Why are you, Brother Nolan, they're ordaining homosexuals now. Listen, that's just a sign of the times. That's what the Lord said would happen, didn't he? It only makes me want to serve him more. It only wants to make me get closer to God, because I know my redemption draweth nigh. He says to him, point number one, how long? Somebody look to your neighbor and say, how long? Mm-hmm. There's nothing wrong with mourning. Mourning's okay, even for us that are Christians. But I want to ask you, how long? Well, preacher, the Bible tells me in Ecclesiastes it's all right in the morning. Sure does. It does. Mourning is okay, Samuel. But also in Ecclesiastes 3 and 4, it says there's a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to... Who said it? Say it loud, please. Oh, I got a Bible reader right here with me tonight. To dance. That's what it says. It says there's a time to mourn and a time to dance. Nothing wrong with dancing in the Holy Ghost. Nothing wrong with dancing with you and your spouse at your house either. I got two of it. There's nothing wrong with that, church. It's not sinful. Okay, nobody believes me. That's all right. Every one of you dance at least one. It's your wife. There's a lot of things the Bible tells you can do with your spouse. We're not that holy, church. There are a lot of children in this church. Okay. Well, he said there's a time to mourn and a time to dance. Mourning's okay, but mourning can't last forever. There are churches still in mourning about a pastor who left 30 years ago. There are church of gods that are closing their door, and you ask them why? Because they're upset about a vote that happened 15 years ago. There are people upset in the church. It should be on the pastor's council, but they're upset about somebody taking their parking space 3 years ago. Mourning. Every time the Holy Ghost tries to work, somebody goes to you and say, did you enjoy church? I sure did, but it would have been even better if the pastor would address that thing that happened 18 years ago. Then you'll know why the world's not coming to the church. Because we act foolish. We're fussing about something that happened a long time ago. Well, I didn't want carpet in the church. Well, you had one vote. You got voted down. Get over it. I'm serious. I'm preaching tonight. I know you wouldn't shout a lot, but that's okay. Tomorrow night, I promise you, you'll shout. But tonight, you're going to listen. That's what's wrong. We're mourning. We're mourning because grandma's feelings got hurt. We're mourning because somebody left us. We're mourning because we lost our job. And we don't see that God is big enough. He gave us that job. God can give us another job. Our focus is in our mourning. And God is trying to let somebody know, I want you to stop mourning because I want you to put your dancing shoes on. But I can't get your dancing shoes on because you won't quit gossiping and crying and bellyaching to everybody that comes along. You're still fussing about something that happened a long time ago. I don't know who I come to preach to tonight, but it's time to quit crying. It's time to do and be who God has called you to be. Yeah. Have 10 minutes. The church is paralyzed. We're stuck in neutral. We are stuck in neutral. We're not moving forward. The world's moving forward. Everybody else is moving forward. And we're stuck in neutral because we are paralyzed by our mourning and paralyzed by our past. There's a time to mourn. There's also a time to dance. And God was letting him know, Samuel, I want you to get this. This is what the Lord spoke to me this morning. I am finished with Saul, but I'm not finished. This is my word to you this night. Receive it, saith the Lord. I'm trying to move you forward for that I have planned for you. It is of me, saith the Lord. Do not be afraid. But you must move in me. You must take that first step and grab a hold of me, and I will lead you. I will guide you, and you will not misstep, saith the Lord. Folks, we're hearing from God tonight. Will you please honor that and give God praise in this house? Let me get to the best part, and I'll close. God was finished with Saul, but God was not finished. I don't know who that's for, but that's what the Lord breathed to me early this morning in Columbia. One person does not hold the keys to the destiny of you nor this church. There's going to be preachers come and go. There's going to be preachers fall. There's going to be laity come and go, but they don't hold the keys to the church. Saul was God's man for a season. Because of his own, some say character flaws, some say hiccups. The old church, Brother Sheila, we just said sin. Because of that in his life, God rejected him. And Samuel is there mourning. We always get to David. Come back to verse 1. David can't anoint himself. He needs the man of God to go. But the man of God can't go because the man of God is still crying. And God has to come down and say, what are you doing? I'm done with Saul. And I've already moved on. You haven't. I feel him tonight. I'm done with Saul. In fact, I've already got somebody else. But I got to get you up to go get him. So I need you to get up. But there's no hope, God. Saul was your man, and that was the problem. One preacher said it this way. He said it like this, that what we do in a crisis depends whether we see the difficulties in the light of God or God in the shadow of difficulties. Whatever painful experiences we go through, God is still God, and he can still give us victory. Verse 1, he says, I'm already provided. Now see, Samuel could understand that. You want to know why? For two reasons. This is my opinion. One, he had a relationship with Saul. And when you have a relationship with somebody, it hurts when they hurt you. If you walk up to me, one of you sisters, and walk up to me and say, Brother Nolan, you an ugly old fella, it won't bother me now. It's like water off a duck's back. God bless you. Hallelujah. You need glasses, but God bless you. But if Sister Nolan walks up to me and says, baby, I just got healed of my eyesight, and I cannot believe I married you. That's going to hurt a little while. You understand? Hurting people hurt people. And Samuel's about to hurt the kingdom because he's been hurt because he has a relationship with Saul. It was Samuel who called him out, brother. It was Samuel that anointed him. It was Samuel that was there, and the thunder came down, and it roared, and the children of Israel knew it was God. It was Samuel, and Samuel raised this man up, and now this man is falling, and Samuel is crying. Secondly, not only was there a relationship, but he was unsure. And when people are unsure, they get desperate. And when they get desperate, they lose hope. And when they lose hope, they get stuck in neutral. And when the church is stuck in neutral, it's not the church. We are a Pentecostal church. We are an Acts church. We move. Even when we're persecuted, we're still moving, and the gospel is still going forward. So because of this, God has to say these words in verse 1. He says, how long will you mourn, seeing I rejected him? Watch this, though. Fill your horn with oil. Go, I'm sending you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided. Somebody say provided. Provided. Do you know what that translates, brother? Can I come down? You know what that translates to? Provided means, in the original text, I have seen to it. When I read that about shouting. Because Samuel is worried about the kingdom. And God is saying, come on. What are you worried about? Well, God, you rejected Saul. What are we going to do? Don't worry about it. I've already saw to it. Somebody needs to hear that tonight. Somebody needs to know what you've been worried about, God's not worried about. And what you've been afraid of, God's not afraid of. And you keep saying, I wouldn't move forward, but I can't because I'm afraid. I'm afraid of this, and I'm afraid I won't have the resources. I'm afraid I won't have the money. Can I tell you something? If God has to send us to the seashore and open the fish's mouth to get what we need. I've come to tell you, I believe that God is a big God. And we're afraid. We're sitting back afraid. And God is telling us, come on, church. Come on, church. Come on, church. But God, I'm worried that we're not going to have it. God, I'm worried. And God told Samuel, what are you afraid of? What are you crying over? I've already saw to that you need in your life. I come to let somebody know God's already saw to it. That healing, God saw to it. Those finances, God saw to it. But you can't get to it until you get up. And as long as you stay there, and I know what you've got, you got two sisters that will stay there with you. You want to know why they'll stay there with you? It's not because they love you. It's not because they love you. You want to know why they stay in mourning with you? Because they are mourning themselves. Is this Woodruff? They're in mourning themselves. And y'all comfort each other. And you tell each other why it's okay that you hadn't prayed for anybody in 2 years. You used to pray and people got healed when you laid hands on them. But because somebody got mad, now you're worried about what they might think. Why don't you worry about what God thinks about it? Because you didn't vote a certain way, you've been stuck in neutral. Because somebody's talked about you on Facebook, help us. I'll fire somebody who causes drama on Facebook. I didn't stutter. We don't hire people to cause drama. If you're going to cause drama, go on to the church down the road. We'll highly recommend you to them. Because we're one. Are you listening tonight? God tells him, I've already saw to it. It means that the situation that you're worried about, he says, I want you to move forward. Because what you need, I have already provided for you. What do you mean, God, you provided? You don't know. God, what do you mean you provided? I don't see nobody. You don't, but I do. God, where's that key gonna come from? If you listen, you can't hear it. But I hear a little boy calling out to me. A boy. God, we need a king. See? That's you again mourning and trying to do my job. God, we need a key. I've already saw to it. Where's he at? Listen, did you hear that? He just slayed a lion with his bare hands. How did he do that, God? Because my spirit came upon him. See, but we can't get to David because we're still mourning over Saul. And I don't know who I can. My closing thoughts is this. How long? You missed a good dance, my friend. Oh, I'm not talking about the physical at the club. You know me better than that. I'm talking about a spiritual dance that I have with my Savior. Like this morning when he woke me up and he said, drift away with me. And I texted my staff and I said, get away with him. Slip away with him today. Don't ask him for nothing. Don't touch him to bless you. Just get away with him and have some intimacy with him. And then come back tomorrow and tell me what he's birthed in you. See, you can't get there while you're still crying over Saul. Watch what happens as I close. Not only do you have to quit mourning, not only do you have to trust God that he saw to it, but lastly, go with me to verse 7. I close, Pastor Terry. He says, but the Lord said to Samuel, do not look at the appearance or physical stature. He said, brother, why would you bring that? Because it's very important. See, what you've got to understand, not only has God saw to it, you have to be careful. Because if you're not careful, brother, this is key. If you're not careful because you have been mourning and you have been hurt, even though you're going forward now, you will go forward still acting and believing like you did while you were mourning. He goes, let me prove it. He goes to Jesse's house and he says, you two come here. Come on, quick. You come here, help me, brother. You two go sit beside your daddy. Come on, quick. Come on. sit right here. If you're not careful, because you just got in this morning and you missed out on a couple good revivals, I'll leave that alone. You get to Jesse's house. And listen, this is where we miss Samuel. We think Samuel is some preacher who's a weakling. The Bible said that they were afraid and asked him, "Have you come in peace?" Preacher, why would they do that? Did you not see what he just did to Agag? He had a wrong perception about the man of God. When he shows up, now he wants to bring a king. I'm done with Saul. So now he says, "Surely it's you." And if you watch the terminology there, he's trying to provide for himself a king. And he says, God said, "Not him. He's tall, he's good looking, he's strong, but he's a flippo, not him." Not Eliab. What about Shammah? Yeah, he's not a flippo. He's good looking. Not him. And you almost see now, went back with Samuel the morning. "Surely, God, it's got to be these." God said, "No. I have provided." Why do you tell us the pastor? Because you don't have to work it out. When you get up for morning, you don't have to fix it. Young people, let me give you a word. Don't date just anybody. Don't try to fix it. I know you're looking for somebody good looking. It's a cheerleader. But make sure that good looking cheerleader is full of the hope. Hello? Don't you try to work it out. You just got up from morning. This has got to be him. No, that's what your flesh says. Your flesh says it's him. But remember, God doesn't need you to provide. He just needs you to get out of neutral. Woodruff, he doesn't need you to provide. He just needs you to get out of neutral. That's God's word. Musicians, if you'll come. That's God's word. What are you afraid of? What has caused you to stumble? Why do you not come after me anymore, saith the Lord? What has caused you to drift away from me? Do you not long for me? Do you not want me anymore, saith the Lord? I'm still God. My words that I've spoken over you are still true. Get up, saith the Lord. Now's the time to come after me, and I will bless you. I will resource you. I will take care of your very needs, saith the Lord of hosts. I want you to stand all over the house quickly. Quickly, quickly. I was going to do a demonstration. Get up, get up, get up, get up, get up, get up. Quickly, quickly. That's God's word. That's God's word. I'm done. That's it. I felt the Holy Ghost say, "That's it. That's the letter. That's what God told me to bring." You've got some great evangelists that come. More proper, better speech, look better than I do. Some have nicer cars and planes. Oh, I'm not jealous. I am who I am. But I tell you this, I have prayed. And I have sought him. I don't ask you for nothing. I don't ask you for anything. I don't ask you for nothing. Except this. Take what I give you. Take it not as my words, but take it as God sent you this. And it'll be well with my soul. Every head bowed, every eye closed. I'm not talking sinner. Oh, I want you to come. I'm talking backslider. Oh, and I do want you to come. But there are some good people. There are some people who've done nothing wrong, but others have caused them to be stuck in neutral. I didn't even bring that out. That's a good point by itself. It wasn't even Samuel's fault. But tonight, I need some people, when I count to three, that would say, "It's me. I've got to get going while there's still time. Because night's coming and I won't be able to work. If you can sing, sing. Preach, preach. You might not get this pulpit. Can I tell you, they didn't give me this pulpit either my first year preaching. I had to preach at the nursing home. I had to pay to do that. But Brother Sheely had burned inside. When you were little, your own eyes saw. Samuel, how long will you want? I've already saw to it. Ooh. A little boy that knows how to praise me. Who's been wooing me. Who's after my own heart. He's been telling me words like this, for the Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not. He maketh me lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. Words like this, for the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? For the Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even my enemies and foes, come upon the end of my flesh, they stumbled and fell. That's who I provided, Saul, Samuel. Don't worry about it. One, this altar shouldn't be full. Well, Brother Nolan, somebody else won't need to hear that. No, 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 no. You. God wants to use you, counselor. Sunday school teacher, God wants to send a revival starting that Sunday school.
You, pastor.
Children's leader, God's speaking to you tonight. Brother Terry, you allow me to speak freely? Where's your children's pastor? Children's pastor. Would you step out? Can I speak to you? I feel God in this house. I want you to get ready for what I got to say, because it's not me. I want you to hear this. Stop right there. Not everybody's going to be your friend. Not everybody's going to see what you're seeing. And that some of them will not like it. I'm obey the Lord, and they will not understand. But they didn't call you. You stay up on the unction of the Holy Ghost and up on the leadership of your pastor, for he will protect you as the wings. But you continue to follow after God, and you love kids. And anybody that doesn't love kids, then how can they love God? That is his word. How can you love who you've not seen and hate those that you do see? So you follow after God with a passion. And don't worry about it if they send you a car to their party. For you have already been invited to a party. And it's a party between you and God. So wipe the tears off your eyes and get to work. And keep being a light in a dark world. And allow God to equip you and anoint you. And that's God. Oh, I feel the Holy Ghost in his eyes. I wish I had about two people come pray with her. I wish I had two people that believed what I just said was God to come pray with her. Come on, somebody. Wake up, church. Go ahead. I was in a revival service a couple weeks ago. We had a preacher preaching. And the Holy Ghost asked me, said, ask him what he needs. And Sister Porter, you understand, that pushed me a little bit. Full-time missionary, and the Spirit of the Lord said, ask him what he needs. So I looked down at this brother, who all his money for missions comes from the church. And I said, brother, I'm going to ask you something. I know it may embarrass you, but I've got to obey the Lord. How much do you need? And I saw tears because he was embarrassed and afraid, not mad with me, but not understanding. I said, brother, I'm going to ask you one more time. The Holy Ghost. And I helped him. I said, how much is your next missions trip? He had been praying for weeks. He says, $2,400. I said, and I felt the Lord say, pay it. Don't you think I'm rich? We had a little money that my sweetie pie and I had put back up. And the Lord said, pay it. And I looked at that brother, I said, brother, don't worry about it. That's paid for. And our church erupted into a spirit of revival. And we saw souls saved and people filled with the Holy Ghost. Amen. I come to let somebody know your God's not broke. Amen. Your God's not dead. And if you'll quit crying and get up in the name of Jesus, God's able.
Thank you.
What you're hearing right now, say the Lord, is rain. And it's an abundance of rain that I told you. It is here to start to sprinkle over you to refresh you. It will sprinkle over you to revive you, but then it will come harder. And the rain will start coming down harder. And it will cause others around you to come back. And others around you have stopped believing, have lost hope. It will cause them to live again. And then the rain's going to get harder. And in that time, it's going to spread out to the community. For those who you never thought would come, they're going to come. And they're going to find life. And the life that they're going to find, it's going to live in them. And others will see. And then they will come. This is the rain. Feel it, saith the Lord. It's a sprinkle now, but it's coming in greater measure. Feel the rain, saith the Lord of hosts. But here we are in the presence of the Lord. Come to the altar quickly. All over the house. Everyone find a place now. Quickly. I'm done. Quickly, all over the house. You should be moving after that word. You should be moving. Presence of the Lord. Come on, get close. Business done. Pastor Bill, Sister Beth, come on. Come on, get close. This other should come.
Let's fire!
Let's fire!
Let it rain.
I've come to worship.
disturb those that are praying around the altar, but beyond hearing the word of the Lord tonight, somehow there's an overwhelming sense of peace and love. I don't know if anybody feels that with me. You know what? I'm a firm believer. Sometimes there are people in our midst who have not been told that they are loved in a long time. You think sometimes in relationships and friendships, we just take it for granted. We don't say those words, but sometimes those are the most powerful, the most liberating, the most energizing words you'll ever hear. And so I want you, if you don't mind, to find somebody. And again, I understand you don't know somebody. It may be hard, but if we're believers in the Lord, then in Christ Jesus, we're blood. We're kin. We love each other. And I want you just to find somebody and let them know. Look them in the eye. Do like I do Emory. I say, look at Poppy in the eye. I do this. Look at me. Look at me in the eye. We'll put foreheads together. And I say it with him looking at me. I love you, Emory. He says to me, I love you, Emory. I say, no. Say, I love you, Poppy. I love you, Poppy. You need to look somebody in the eye and tell them you love them. Can you do that? I'm telling you, there's something liberating, something energizing, something about telling them that you love them. What a move of God we've had tonight. I'm so thankful for these children that are in the altar. Would you please pray for Brother Neil? Before church, he had someone in his church family that apparently has had a heart attack, and he couldn't get hold of any of his other people to check on that, so he slipped out. He wanted you to know where he went. He's not trying to run out on you, but he's trying to get back so he can check on that person in the hospital. I want us to pray that whatever God has done tonight does not leave us, but that we bring it with us in the morning. I believe Pastor Sheely has a word from the Lord that he's going to bring to us. Father God, we thank you. We praise you. We honor and adore you. I thank you, Lord, that while you may be finished with certain aspects, certain things in our life, you are not finished. That you're calling us, Lord, to get up from where we are and to press forward. We receive that word tonight. I believe, God, some people in this room receive that word tonight. And things are going to be different from this point forward. Pray, God, that as others continue to pray around the altar, those that may need to leave, that you'll go with us, that you will touch us and strengthen us and help us, give us rest in our bodies tonight. Let us come refreshed in the morning and again tomorrow night. God, we love you. We thank you for what you're doing. In the wonderful name of Jesus. I'm not going to put an amen on the prayer because I don't want it to be over. If you need to go, you go. Those that are still praying, still want to worship, we're going to leave it wide open for you. God bless you.